I believe we're at the end of an era. We're in the last quarter century to last half century of fossil fuels as our dominant energy regime.
I think we have to say that hydrocarbon man, and this is today the only remaining subspecies, he's extinct at the end of this century, you know.
The good news. There's a new energy regime at the front door, and the world's turning to it, and it's hydrogen.
Tonight, I'm proposing $1.2 billion in research funding so that America can lead the world in developing clean, hydrogen-powered automobiles.
Who can get excited about hydrogen? But you can get excited about radical reductions in the environmental consequences of our economy and radical reductions in the tensions produced by oil dependency.
There's no doubt it'll create a new economic dynamic. Just as computers and the internet did, this is going to be potentially bigger.
If we want to begin the conversion of that entire system moving toward hydrogen, it's a huge capital undertaking, on the order of hundreds of billions of dollars.
We will engage a great global debate on this over the next 10 years. Certainly, it's the most important single discussion we're going to have as we move into the 21st century.
But to do that, we have to start immediately, now.
In IJsland baden de mensen letterlijk in duurzame energie. Stoom en heet water komen gratis uit de vulkanische bodem. De IJslanders maken er op grote schaal goedkope warmte en elektriciteit van. Eind april 2003 vond op het eiland een historische gebeurtenis plaats. IJsland gaf het startschot voor de overgang naar een totale waterstofeconomie.
I declare the hydrogen station open.
Waarom wil het energieparadijs IJsland volledig overgaan op waterstof? Waarom rijden er in een aantal Europese steden inmiddels dit soort waterstofbussen rond? Waarom hebben alle autofabrikanten wereldwijd waterstofauto's in ontwikkeling? Omdat waterstof hot is. En na het verschijnen van het boek De Waterstofeconomie van publicist en politiek adviseur Jeremy Rifkin dreigt het zelfs een hype te worden.
I feel that we're at one of those critical points in history where we have to rethink our energy regime. We're in the last stages of a fossil fuel era, and making that transition out of that energy regime into a new energy regime, hydrogen, is going to be the test for civilization, the test for the next three generations. Can we meet the challenge? You know, civilizations come and go for a lot of reasons. We've had, what, 25, 30 great civilizations in the world, but many of them collapse because they deplete their energy regime and they don't have the foresight nor the availability of a new energy regime to save them. So we're really at a pivotal point in history in the next 10 to 20 years, and the decisions are being made now. And that's why I wrote the book, to say to the world, we need to now focus on the next energy era, hydrogen.
Om 10:55 in de ochtend van de 28e februari vloeide onder een luid hoezee de eerste olie in de eerste ketel van de koninklijke.
Al meer dan een eeuw leven we met olie. Leven we van goedkope olie. Het heeft de moderne wereld gevormd en afhankelijk gemaakt. Olie is het bloed van onze samenleving.
It's all about energy. In other words, we live and die by energy. Every human being lives by converting energy in the surrounding environment into our body. Our body uses it and then it expels it. We are an energy carrier. And to the extent that energy is denied, either a human or a community or society, that's the impoverishment of that community. So energy is critical to everything. Look at the oil era. You know, the public doesn't think about it much, but this whole 20th century that we just left was all about oil. We grow our food in petrochemical fertilizers and pesticides. Our clothes are primarily made out of synthetic petrochemicals. Our pharmaceutical products are primarily derived from petrochemicals. Our plastics, our building material, our power, our heat, our light, it's all oil. So when we began to take a look at the oil era, we have to ask some fundamental questions. Do we have an energy regime that can continue to provide our needs into the 21st century? The clear answer to that is no. The conventional wisdom is that we have about 40 years left of cheap crude oil till we reach peak. Now, peak is a petrogeology term. Peak is when half of your known oil reserves, either already known or yet to be discovered, are used up. At a 2% growth rate in the use of oil in the world, which is a kind of a middle scenario, the U.S. Geological Survey, the Department of Energy in my country, says we will peak with oil in 2037. That's the end of the era. However, in the last 3 or 4 years, about a dozen of the best petrogeologists in the world, world-class geologists, have been re-looking at the numbers with new computer studies, and they're saying we may have gotten the numbers wrong.
April 2003. Die internationale geologen komen bij elkaar voor een conferentie in het Franse Staatsinstituut voor Petroleum. Een conferentie georganiseerd door ASPO, een club van bezorgde geologen die de wereld willen overtuigen van de problemen met de wereldolievoorraad. Een van de initiatiefnemers van ASPO is Colin Campbell. Hij schreef in 1998 al een geruchtmakend artikel in Scientific American met de titel Het einde van de goedkope olie.
En de derde missie is om te proberen awareness of dit very critical subject.
We're not running out of oil. That is the first important thing to say. People ask, are we running out of oil? Well, since oil was formed in the geological past, we started running out when we produced the first barrel. So this question of running out, which is a popular question, actually has not much meaning. What is important is the peak and the onset of decline. We've been production growing for 150 years. Now we reach the top and it begins to decline. So when we used the word cheap oil, we were trying to give this impression that the easy stuff is over and the more expensive and more difficult oil has to follow, but only at a much slower rate than what we're used to. The technology of exploration has improved enormously. We now have seismic surveys like a scan of the Earth of extremely high resolution. We can see every little corner around. But in the early days, we didn't need that. When you were looking for a big one, you didn't need to see it so easily. So we look for these. We can now find a needle in a haystack, put it that way. We can find a needle in a haystack, but it's a needle. It's small. It doesn't make any difference. So you keep on. You can look around and you can do all kinds of things, but you get less and less and less.
Wanneer is het tijdperk van de goedkope olie voorbij? De Amerikaanse oliehoogleraar Kenneth DeFace schreef een boek over de oliepiek met als titel Hubbert's Peak.
I want to draw an analogy between what happened in the decade of the 1970s and what's happening right now. This is Hubbert's original 1956 illustration.
It looks as if we have gone over the peak that we had long dreaded, that world oil production would start to fall. And I'm now quite convinced that the year 2000 was the peak of oil production, and we're going to have to do with smaller amounts and more expensive oil.
What does it mean, this peak?
It's simply the expression of the hypothesis that the ease of finding oil depends on how much oil is still left. So that at first, of course, all the oil is left when you begin drilling the first, and so you have great successes. Then gradually, as you catch most of the fish out of the pond, it gets harder to catch fish. And it's that slowing down of the discovery rate that already happened 20 years ago, and now it's beginning to show up in the production rate, and it's quite inevitable. There's nothing on the horizon that will prevent oil production from going down. There's some disagreement as to what year it will happen, and I happen to be one of the pessimists who says it's not only going to happen, it has happened.
Champagne, yes. If we squeeze in 100 gigabarrels of oil into the champagne bottles, we have used 9 bottles so far. 9 bottles.
And if you look at how much we have in the refrigerator, it's something like 9 bottles. And if you're happy, we might find 2 or 3 more. I mean, that's all when you talk about oil. And 5 out of these bottles are in the Middle East, and the rest are spread around the world. So, it's quite interesting. I mean, you have Iraq, for instance, now. 1 bottle of champagne is exactly the amount of oil that you have in Iraq. So, if you open up that bottle and pour it into 4 glasses, you get exactly so much you are using each year. So, in principle, it will only take 4 years for the world to empty Iraq.
Why not open the bottle and do that? But you know what this represents? This glass. This is the yearly consumption of oil in the world. 1 glass of champagne.
For instance, there was 2 bottles of champagnes in the United States.
That is the total amount of oil that once was in the United States. 200 gigabarrels. And they have filled their last glass now, because this is just roughly what they have left. And they are sipping the last glass. Skål.
Een luchtige manier om te vertellen wat er met olie aan de hand is. Maar er zijn ook aanzienlijk dreigender woorden te vinden. Ali Samsam Bakhtiari, een topman van de Iraanse staatsoliemaatschappij.
There won't be enough energy for everybody to go around. That's going to be the main problem. Because look, you are now, the Indians and the Chinese are starting to consume more and more energy. They are selling 5,000 cars every day in China. That needs gasoline. And it's going to get more and more and more. And the West needs energy. They have shut off all their nuclear reactors, like Sweden, and like maybe Germany now. So where do you get all that energy from if there is not enough oil? That will create enormous problems.
And there is not enough oil. That's what you're actually saying. Iran, in Iraq.
There is not going to be enough oil very, very soon. Now, that very soon might be 2 years, might be 3 years, might be 4 years, but in any event, it will not take a decade. It will be way before 2010. My prediction is around 2005, 2006. It's not very far. I can only imagine what is going to happen. I have different scenarios, but the only thing I know for sure, it's going to change the life of 90 5% of the world.
Well, the story here is it's going to be reflected in the price, that the price of oil is going to go up and down, and every time it goes down, people will say, see, there was no oil crisis. And in fact, it'll go up again and down again, up again and down again. And natural gas has been doing that in the market in North America. Now, in the case of oil, up until now, OPEC had the stated mission of keeping oil at around $27 a barrel. And I say it, the good news is that OPEC is no longer in control of oil prices. The bad news is nobody's in control of oil prices.
Nobody?
Nobody, they'll fluctuate.
My country, when oil prices go up, people would immediately say, oh my God, oil and gas at the pump is going to be too expensive for my car. What they don't realize is that when we reach peak on oil, there are other sectors that are going to be even more difficult. 17% of all the fossil fuel energy used in my country goes to food, producing it, processing it, packaging it, and marketing it. So as we move toward peak in oil production, imagine when oil prices and natural gas prices shoot through the roof. Imagine the price of a loaf of bread. We now take it for granted that it's a cheap commodity. But imagine the price when 17% of the energy of the country goes into processing and making food. So we have to understand it's all about oil.
Het olieregime begint te kraken. Het veroorzaakt niet alleen economische instabiliteit, maar ook een mondiale klimaatsverandering. Met in het hart ons lustobject, de auto.
Speed and youth. These are the things we strive to put in every motor car. The perfect form, the pleasing line, the promise of dynamic performance. In the car, of course.
De uitstoot van kooldioxide is zo groot dat het een enorm veiligheidsrisico begint te worden. De Amerikaanse trendwatcher Peter Schwartz probeerde onlangs samen met het Pentagon via een rampenscenario president Bush te overtuigen van deze enorme dreiging.
Our third goal is to promote energy independence for our country while dramatically improving the environment.
You know, I think many people are already concerned about global warming and climate change. But I think the issue may be even more urgent than has been seen so far. There's very strong evidence that what we are in the early stages of is a period of abrupt climate change, i.e. the world will get warmer and then get much colder. It'll significantly affect Northern Europe, the Netherlands. In Dutch history, you can remember what the Little Ice Age was like when you could do this, the 11 cities race. In the winter, and you could do it every year. Well, now you can't do it every year because it's so warm. Well, we could return to that environment when it was bitter cold and sometimes no summer in Northern Europe. Now, the dramatic increase in CO2 coming from more and more automobiles, more and more transportation, and so on, is one of the driving forces producing the warming that's leading to the cooling. So there may be urgent reason to reduce our CO2 production much more rapidly than even Kyoto envisages.
I believe we're at the end of an era that began with the carrying of coal to Newcastle and is now winding down in the Middle East. We're in the last quarter century to last half century of fossil fuels as our dominant energy regime. The good news, there's a new energy regime at the front door, and the world's turning to it, and it's hydrogen.
Als je waterstof verbrandt, hou je energie en puur schoon water over. Het is dan ook de schoonste brandstof die er bestaat. Er is alleen één probleem. Het komt niet zomaar vrij in de natuur voor. Het zit bijvoorbeeld verstopt in kolen, olie, gas. Daar kun je het uithalen.
Most of the hydrogen we're getting now is by steaming hydrogen out of natural gas. Problem is, natural gas is going to peak somewhere around the time oil peaks. So even if we use it, it's only a short-term transition. You could even get hydrogen out of coal, but then you've got carbon dioxide to worry about. You could have nuclear power extracting hydrogen, but the problem with that is that we have no way to get rid of nuclear waste. That should be a deal breaker. We don't want to burden future generations with even more nuclear waste. And secondly, all the power companies I work with, they don't want to build nuclear power plants. They can't afford them.
They're too expensive.
They're too expensive. I work with some of the biggest power companies in the world. None of them are talking about building new power plants. The companies in North America have lost a third of their equity in the last 2 years. They have a liquidity crisis. They're building gas-fired power plants because they're cheap. Now, unless the government and the taxpayers want to pay for all of the nuclear power, and I don't think we do, it's not realistic. And finally, nuclear power doesn't deal with homeland security. The thought of building all these additional nuclear power plants to extract hydrogen is insane. Because what we really worry about in homeland security is threats to our power structure. 9/11 was a symbolic attack against symbolisms of the United States, the World Trade Center, the Pentagon. What we're now really worried about is the next attacks will be against the power plants and the transmission lines that provide the energy for society. And the thought of nuclear power plants all over Europe and America and Japan and the world, they're sitting there as a target for any two or three terrorists that want to blow up a nuclear power plant, say goodbye to part of Europe. So my belief is that there's another way to do this. We know there's another way to extract hydrogen. We can extract it from water. Eventually, maybe directly from sunlight. There's experiments going on. But right now, water. We take renewable energies like wind, solar photovoltaic, hydro, geothermal, and biomass, renewable energy technologies, generate electricity locally when you can. Some of the electricity you use immediately for power. The electricity you don't need, the surplus, you take it and you electrolyze water, like you did in high school chemistry, grab the hydrogen.
Zo moeilijk is waterstof maken dus niet. Stuur elektriciteit door water en het splitst zich in zuurstof en waterstof. Waterstof is een kleurloos gas dat je kunt opslaan. Je kunt het proces ook omkeren. Breng waterstof en zuurstof weer bij elkaar in een zogeheten brandstofcel en je krijgt puur water en je elektriciteit terug. Het is een ideaal middel om energie op te slaan. Maar dan moet je wel energie hebben. Waar halen we energie vandaan om waterstof te maken, zonder afhankelijk te zijn van olie of kernenergie? Wereldwijd worden geëxperimenteerd met duurzame bronnen als zonne-energie. In de Mojave-woestijn staat de grootste zonnecentrale ter wereld. Al 10 jaar levert deze centrale elektriciteit. Elektriciteit die zeer goed om te zetten is in waterstof. Het zijn dit soort centrales die de aanzet kunnen zijn voor een schone waterstof-economie.
Hydrogen economy is dependent on gathering hydrogen or creating hydrogen some way. If you need to make the power to separate water to make hydrogen, you still need energy in some way. It would be a beautiful match of solar power to generating hydrogen because this plant, in feeding an electric grid, is always struggling with the amount of sunshine available and the constant need for power on the grid. If a plant like this was producing energy to produce hydrogen, then it would just be whenever the sun shines, you produce the hydrogen, you have a storage facility, a backlog of hydrogen, and would make a wonderful complement to a utilization of hydrogen. That way you would be taking the energy from the sun to produce the hydrogen fuel, and then a hydrogen fuel would produce nothing but water vapor, and you would have no emissions on the entire cycle.
Wereldwijd zijn er genoeg schone bronnen waarmee energie opgewekt kan worden. Maar die bronnen leveren meestal alleen elektriciteit. En wat we willen is een echte brandstof. Alleen als we duurzame bronnen combineren met waterstof, is een grootschalig duurzaam schoon energiesysteem mogelijk. Zo stelt Rivkin.
We cannot have a renewable energy society, the kind we're envisioning, without hydrogen. It's the storage carrier. Hydrogen is not a primary energy, it's a storage carrier. And here's what I mean by this. When you generate electricity, it flows. You can't store electricity. So if you're generating electricity for all of Europe with wind and solar, photovoltaic, hydro and geothermal and biomass, what if the wind stops blowing for a few days? It happens. What if the sun stops shining? What if the water isn't flowing because of drought? Your electricity stops. So Hydrogen's the way to store renewable energy, not only for electricity, but for power, for transport, for automobiles, trucks, everything else.
Elektriciteit omzetten in brandstof, waterstof. Dat is precies wat IJsland besloten heeft om te gaan doen. Het vulkanische eiland heeft schone en goedkope elektriciteit in overvloed. Overal komt er hete stoom uit de bodem en er zijn watervallen. Die duurzame energie wordt nu al grootschalig gebruikt om warmte en elektriciteit te maken. Met die elektriciteit wil men waterstof gaan maken voor de auto's en de visserijvloot van het eiland. Op termijn wil men volkomen olie-onafhankelijk en zelfs waterstofexporteur worden. Daarom werd in april 2003 dan ook het eerste openbare waterstoftankstation geopend. Onder andere in samenwerking met onverwachte partners als Daimler Chrysler en Shell.
Today's event represents a historic milestone in the search for sustainable energy.
Het eiland wordt een speeltuin voor Shell, want het oliebedrijf is al langer met waterstof bezig.
In Shell maken we scenario's, dus dat zijn verschillende toekomstplaatjes die zouden kunnen gebeuren. En dan zagen we eigenlijk in ieder scenario zagen we een rol voor duurzame energie, maar ook een rol voor waterstof. Weliswaar weten we niet precies hoe laat, maar toen hebben we gezegd, daar gaan we toch mensen op zetten.
Waarom waterstof?
Waterstof heeft één heel groot voordeel. Dat is op het moment dat je het verbrandt, die waterstof, komen er geen uitlaatgassen vrij die kwaad kunnen. Er zijn natuurlijk allerlei andere nadelen die je moet kunnen overwinnen. Die hebben te maken met technologie en veiligheid. Maar ja, dat zeggen wij, dan kan je dus zien als een nadeel. Maar dat kan je ook zien als een kans voor Shell. Want wij zijn dus juist gewoon goed in technologie en het beheersen van veiligheid. Ja.
Nou heeft waterstof een groot probleem, namelijk het is er niet zomaar.
Ja, daarom, ik zei ook heel zorgvuldig, we zien een grote plaats voor duurzame energie en waterstof. Want als je waterstof maakt uit aardgas, wat heel goed kan, dan is het natuurlijk geen echte duurzame energie. Waterstof is pas duurzame energie als je het zou kunnen maken uit elektriciteit. Dat kan door het splitsen van water. Maar dan moet je weer, dan krijg je weer de vraag, hoe maak je dan die elektriciteit? En dan hier bijvoorbeeld waar we nu zijn op IJsland, daar maken ze die elektriciteit, witte kracht, hè, uit het water enzovoort. Dus dan is het inderdaad wel duurzame energie. Maar waterstof zou dus een ideaal middel kunnen zijn om energie als het ware te vervoeren. Maar je moet het eerst gemaakt hebben.
Je gebruikt duurzame bronnen, je vangt die energie op en je zet het om in waterstof.
Ja, het is dus een medium om energie te transporteren. Ja.
Maar dan klinkt het een beetje alsof Shell van de fossiele brandstof af wil.
Wij zeggen altijd, Shell is een energie- en petrochemisch bedrijf. Als ik naar energie kijk, vinden wij het dus prima om andere brandstoffen, of hoe ik dan andere stoffen voor uw auto te leveren. Of u nou bij ons benzine komt tanken of waterstof komt tanken, we willen aan allebei, als het er is, heel groot en heel goed zijn.
Most of the stations so far have been built on depots or in industrial complexes. For us in Iceland, if you're aiming for a hydrogen society, it's very important that we actually make it visible and that the public can come in close proximity to both the infrastructure and also then ride on the buses. And we think that's a very important issue. And therefore we built the station on an existing petrol station. And that's the first time anyone has done that.
Yeah, you really want people to see it.
Yeah, we think the only way to introduce hydrogen into the world is that we have a full social acceptance of the fuel. And if the public cannot see it and feel safe around hydrogen, then of course it will be difficult to evaluate the social acceptance.
Thank you.
Is this the first time you drive in it?
In this car?
Yeah.
Yes. This is the first time I drive in this vehicle.
It sounds very electric.
Yes. That was when we got the test drive of the fuel cell buses. That was exactly the feeling I got. But there was a very kind of a, you get the same feeling as you're driving an electric car. And you hear, the noise you hear is more or less like an electric motor. And that's the only noise, but you can almost hear more noise inside than you hear outside. That's a nice drive.
De vraag is waarom we niet al veel eerder met waterstof begonnen zijn. De reden is simpel. De technologie was gewoon nog niet goed genoeg. In de auto zit een brandstofcel. Een systeem dat waterstof en zuurstof elektrochemisch omzet in water en energie. Een systeem dat bekend is van de ruimtevaart. In de jaren 60 werden brandstofcellen gebruikt om tijdens de maanvluchten astronauten van elektriciteit en schoon drinkwater te voorzien. Alleen waren ze extreem duur en ze gingen maar kort mee. Eind jaren 70 begon de Canadees Ballard een klein bedrijf. Het doel? De ontwikkeling van een goedkope en duurzame brandstofcel. De autogigant Daimler Chrysler heeft nu bijna een kwart van de aandelen. Honderden miljoenen later is er nu een nieuw type brandstofcel. Maar wat is die brandstofcel nu precies? De firma Ballard legt het even zelf uit.
A PEM fuel cell is made of a catalyst-coated membrane between two plates. Hydrogen is fed on one side, oxygen on the other. The hydrogen splits into a proton, which goes through the membrane, and an electron, which is captured as useful electricity. Proton and the electron combine with the oxygen, generating water and heat. A fuel cell will operate continuously as long as fuel is supplied. By combining single cells, a fuel cell stack can be made to produce the required amount of power.
Door de stormachtige ontwikkeling die de brandstofcel de afgelopen jaren heeft doorgemaakt, zijn ze nu pas klein en krachtig genoeg om overal te worden ingezet als stroombron. En daarmee komt het eind van de verbrandingsmotor in zicht. Die kan namelijk vervangen worden door een elektromotor. De elektriciteit komt uit de brandstofcel die gevoed wordt met waterstof. Opeens nemen oliemaatschappijen, autofabrikanten en overheden waterstof heel serieus. Brussel, 16 mei 2003. Europese en Amerikaanse beleidsmakers ontmoeten elkaar in het Europese ministerie voor Handel. Want Amerika is druk bezig met waterstof. Maar Europa loopt zeker niet achter. De Amerikaanse minister van Energiezaken Abrahams en de Europese minister van Onderzoek Busquin ondertekenen een samenwerkingsovereenkomst om de technische ontwikkeling op het gebied van waterstof op elkaar af te stemmen. En natuurlijk ook hier een conferentie.
The European Commission believes that hydrogen is a key element in our future energy policy. And I hope that these today's discussions in Brussels will provide new impetus of our initiatives in this area.
Europa gaat miljarden stoppen in het onderzoek naar waterstof. Fundamenteel materiaalonderzoek, onderzoek naar de distributie van waterstof, naar de mogelijkheden om waterstof te gebruiken in schepen, bussen, auto's en zelfs scooters. Romano Prodi, onze eigen Europese president, kent ook de problemen van de olie- en het broeikaseffect. Daarom is hij een fervent aanhanger van de waterstofrevolutie.
Hydrogen, it seems that hydrogen is the solution. So I think that is our political obligation to put money, energy, intelligence in it to find the solution. But to do that, we have to start immediately, now.
Let me talk a little bit about the politics of this. I serve as an advisor to Romano Prodi, the president of the European Commission, the governing body of the European Union. Last March, I presented him with a long strategic memorandum on how the European Union could make a step-by-step transition out of the current fossil fuel age and into a totally integrated, renewable-based hydrogen economy. He and I spent some time on this. He gave the green light. 6 months later, in October, in Brussels, the European Union announced a high-level partnership between the European Union and European industry and civil society to create the first operational roadmap to becoming a fully integrated renewable hydrogen economy by mid-century.
Today we are focusing on a very simple element indeed, the simplest of all, that is hydrogen.
When President Prodi made his announcement last year, American companies became alarmed and they said, why don't we have a government business partnership in the U.S.? We don't want to be left out of the new energy era. They lobbied the White House, and in his State of the Union address in January, President Bush announced that hydrogen would be our future in the United States, and he said we have to get off oil.
A simple chemical reaction between hydrogen and oxygen generates energy, which can be used to power a car, producing only water, not exhaust fumes. New national commitment, our scientists and engineers will overcome obstacles to taking these cars from laboratory to showroom so that the first car driven by a child born today could be powered by hydrogen and pollution free.
I definitely feel that the next generation, their first cars will be hydrogen-based fuel cell vehicles. In fact, I believe that my daughter, who's currently 5 years old, her first car could be a fuel cell vehicle.
And you're working on that.
And I'm working to make that happen, yes.
Het lijkt erop of de teksten van president Bush in de State of the Union regelrecht ingefluisterd zijn door de industrie. Met name door de grootste autofabrikant ter wereld, General Motors.
Tonight I'm proposing $1.2 billion in research funding, so that America can lead the world in developing clean, hydrogen-powered automobiles.
De grootste autofabrikant General Motors steekt meer geld in de ontwikkeling van waterstof dan de hele Amerikaanse overheid. En General Motors is niet de enige die experimenteert met waterstof. Daimler Chrysler, Honda, Ford en dus ook General Motors, allemaal willen ze waterstofauto's op de markt brengen.
Our goal is to have the technology ready and beginning to put things in showrooms around the beginning of the next decade. That's not very far when you consider that it takes about 4 years to develop and productize a car. So here we are at 2003 and we're talking about doing something in 2010 or 11. That's an incredibly short period of time.
We need to remove the automobile from the environmental debate. We believe automobile transportation has to be environmentally sustainable long term. And as the industry leader, General Motors really felt obligated to lead the charge, to be the first auto company that could build and sell a million fuel cell vehicles profitably. And that's really what our goal is.
This is a complete reinvention of the automobile. The only thing that's consistent is the fact it's got four wheels still. We call it a skateboard. It's really a large box sitting on four wheels. And in the ultimate embodiment, you would have wheel motors at each corner. And that's something that we believe very strongly will happen. So the ultimate vision would be fuel cells powered by hydrogen. So it would be environmentally very friendly. And the electricity that the fuel cell provides would go to each corner. And you would have four wheel motors, one at each corner. And that way you can do a lot of very exciting things from a maneuverability and vehicle stability standpoint.
Tot nog toe was de auto een vervoermiddel. Waterstof gaat daar een totaal nieuwe functie aan toevoegen. De brandstofcel in de auto levert namelijk zoveel elektriciteit dat de auto opeens ook een rijdende elektriciteitscentrale wordt. En daarmee begint de waterstofrevolutie pas echt.
There's opportunity to do a lot more things with your vehicle. You can really improve the functionality in the vehicle if you have that much power on board. You can begin to export power, so you could run various appliances on board the vehicle as well as offboard the vehicle at a campsite or at a job site where you wanted to provide electricity for power tools.
So I can just take my stereo from home, put it in the car and
plug it in
and
power your campsite or power an activity that you had at a picnic, let's say. So you'd have portable power on board your vehicle.
And take every appliance from home and plug it into my car.
You certainly could do that, yes.
It's kind of interesting to look at some big picture numbers. Automobiles are typically 75 kilowatt to 100 kilowatt machines. When you're sitting in your home or at work, you typically need 7 to 10 kilowatts to support your energy requirements. So your automobile generates 10 times the amount of power that you need when you're not in your automobile. And interestingly, you're in your automobile only about 10% of the day. So here's this piece of capital that you've purchased, the car. You use it just 10% of the day, and it has 10 times the power generating capability that you need the other 90% of the day. Something's got to give here. We had an interesting situation in the United States where the state of California was experiencing brownouts because they had electricity shortages. If in that particular time only one in 25 automobiles had a fuel cell in them, and those fuel cell vehicles could have been plugged into the California grid system, they would have doubled their electric generating capability in the state.
I have sent you a comprehensive energy plan to promote energy efficiency and conservation, to develop cleaner technology, and to produce more energy at home.
A fuel cell is what we call scalable. That is, I can make a small fuel cell like this, which could power a house. By the way, this one could power a house, and it's still pretty small, you know, so it fits on my desk.
This could power a house?
Yeah. That's 10 kilowatts worth of power, so that could power a house. Or a larger one which could power a car. And so consequently, we can scale the fuel cell to the application. You don't have to build great big things. You can make small ones, you can make big ones. An electrolyzer which makes hydrogen from electricity is fundamentally a fuel cell run backwards. So it means that I can build a small electrolyzer for small applications and only invest the amount of money I need to, or make a big one. So it's entirely possible that you might have a home refueler in your garage that would be making hydrogen from natural gas, making hot water from the waste heat, making electricity for your house, and making hydrogen for your car. So again, very, very different model than the current big centralized electric utilities, big centralized hydrogen generation plants. The exciting thing about that, just as we've learned with computers, is when you get decentralized systems, they're not only more economic, they're more reliable. Because if something happens locally, you've got things that can pick up the energy and keep the grid going. So you get more reliable systems, more versatile systems, and more cost-effective systems. It's a bit like the computer revolution. I think when people were designing the first computers to do some specific calculations, they began to see potential. When you start thinking about hydrogen and fuel cells, with this idea that fuel cells can make electricity, that hydrogen can be made from many, many energy sources, I think creative people are going to find all kinds of wonderful ways to create this infrastructure. I'll give you an example. It turns out that entrepreneurs around the world are starting to talk about something called microgrids, which is the idea that a local neighborhood would share electricity back and forth. Suppose the notion that you have electrical generation at your house, you're making hydrogen, you may even plug your car into your house. So consequently, you've got several sources right there in your house of how the electricity would be created. You could choose to use your car, you could choose to use the electric grid, you could choose to use a small generator at your house, but you could also choose to share that with your neighbors.
To understand the enormity of this revolution, we have to understand the convergence of two technology revolutions going on right now. The great economic changes in history occur when two things happen. One, a basic change in the way people organize the energy of the earth. Two, a basic change in the way people communicate with each other to organize the new energy. Here's what I mean. You get your fuel cell for your industrial park, your factory, your home, or your office. The fuel cell is analogous to a personal computer. You're generating your own energy instead of some big power company. You generate your own content. Then what do you do with the surplus electricity you don't need? You send it back to the grid. But the power grid is now centralized like communication was. So here's the mission. The Hewlett-Packards of the world, all of the hardware and the software and the smart technology that decentralizes the communications, is going to be used to decentralize every power grid in the Netherlands and around the world so that when you generate electricity with hydrogen fuel, you can send your surplus peer-to-peer to whoever you want on the grid in real time, just like you send information. The coming together of decentralized communication and distributive decentralized hydrogen energy is power to the people.
Power to the people. Maar zover is het nog niet. De waterstofrevolutie staat nog in de kinderschoenen. Het laat zich goed vergelijken met het begin van het computertijdperk.
Yeah, we're actually still in the fairly early stages. That is, we're probably somewhere in the 1960s. We've got big mainframe computers. We're just seeing the beginnings of microchips. And it's hard to imagine the world that the PC is coming along in a decade and completely going to transform the world of computing. But you can see the early stages. And that's what we're beginning to see. For example, the first likely applications of fuel cells are not going to be cars or buildings, but laptops. Microfuel cells, fuel cells that power your laptop or battlefield radios or your PDA, where you put a small capsule of fuel, a capsule like a disposable lighter, into your laptop and you power it on the airplane for 8 to 12 hours. I'm a director of a company, Nia Power, that is developing that technology, but there's 20 others developing similar technologies, basically for portable electronics, because the batteries don't last long enough and there's no new battery technology. So that'll be the first stage, and then we'll see buildings, then we'll see cars, and we'll see a gradual development of the technology in a lot of new ways of that sort.
Als we de auto als elektriciteitscentrale gaan gebruiken. Als we met duurzame bronnen schone waterstof gaan maken. Als we thuis zelf waterstof kunnen maken. Als de wereld echt besluit op waterstof over te stappen, dan betekent dat een enorme technologische en economische verandering.
There's no doubt it'll create a new economic dynamic. Just as computers and the internet did. This is going to be potentially bigger. When you look at the automotive industry in the United States, it, depending on who you talk to, it accounts for about 1 out of 7 jobs. When you add to it the electric systems and all of those things, you're talking about a huge chunk of all modern economies, whether it's the United States, in Europe, Japan, and in fact, a growing segment of the Chinese and other markets. And so consequently, yes, it is a historic change. Much like introduction of electricity, much like the introduction of the automobile and petroleum. It's of that magnitude.
The coming together of decentralized communication as the command and control mechanism to share energy horizontally across the world, it's the third industrial revolution. It will be powerful in its impact as the coming together of the print revolution with steam, coal, and rail, which was the first industrial revolution, and the multiplier effect was the entire 19th century. It will be as powerful as impact as the coming together of telegraph, telephone, electricity with oil in the internal combustion engine, second industrial revolution, multiplier effect, the 20th century. So we're on the verge of a third industrial revolution, decentralized communication to reconfigure our power regime so we have decentralized distributed hydrogen.
Als de waterstofrevolutie echt plaats gaat vinden, dan zijn de economische gevolgen dus enorm. Alle grote industrieën zullen erbij betrokken zijn. General Motors heeft laten doorrekenen wat de financiële gevolgen zijn en zij kunnen haast niet wachten om ermee te beginnen.
If you look at the 50 biggest companies in the world, nearly half of them are going to be directly impacted by hydrogen and by fuel cells. Those are automobile companies, utilities, petroleum companies, very large companies. We've calculated that that corresponds to nearly $2 trillion in revenue that could be disrupted as a result of this technology. That's a huge business growth opportunity for those companies that are on the front end of this revolution, that have secured the intellectual property and the know-how in order to participate as a growth company within the hydrogen economy. This is more than a technology and design exercise. This clearly is an example of GM thinking big. We're very serious about this type of technology as a forerunner for future vehicles.
On the one hand, I congratulate Dutch Shell and BP. They're 8 years ahead of the curve. They understand this transition to renewables and hydrogen. On the other hand, I'm leery of them because they're going to want, they've already patented a lot of the renewable technologies. They have licenses for the hydrogen. Will they run this whole regime? The power and utility companies, at first they didn't care about distributive generation. They didn't see it as a threat. Then they said, well, wait a minute. What if everyone does generate their own energy? What do we do? Well, in the last year or two, they're looking at fuel cells more positively because they have so little liquidity they can't even build gas-fired power plants, but they want to control the fuel cell. So the companies I work with now are saying, you know what, we like fuel cells. We'll put it in your home. You don't have to pay for it. You pay for 30 days of power. We'll put the fuel cell in your home, your office, your factory. You pay for 30 days of power. The software will send the excess back to the grid and we'll give you a discount on your bill. What I'm suggesting and what I've said in this book is we're going to have to organize the end users as a collective political movement so that we're not the victims of a process that could allow power to the people. That means in Europe, for example, the big producer and consumer cooperatives are going to have to organize all their members to buy the fuel cells so they're generating the electricity and then work a deal with the power companies to run the grid. In my country, the real estate developers are going to have to go to the power companies and say, look, we're building 2,000 units for homes here. You, the power company, put in all the technology free for the fuel cells, and then we'll give you a 30-year contract. We'll sell you our energy. In other words, we're going to have a movement, collective political movement, to organize the end users so we control our power.
This is a transition of historic magnitude. The end state, I think, is a better state for the world. And so I think the role that the media play, the role that governments play, the role that maybe I play as a spokesman for General Motors is to try and put it in the proper perspective so that the electorate, so that the government, policymakers, so that the thinkers of the world will do the right things. This is a huge transition. You're dealing with the underpinnings of the economy of the world, and therefore it has to be done with great intelligence and great insight.
Some people say it's too complicated, it's too expensive.
Well, the issue of complexity, I think, is a non-issue. Look, I was in the oil business. I headed scenario planning for Royal Dutch Shell. It's a complicated business. We know how to run big, complicated business. Think about LNG, for example, where, you know, you're getting natural gas, say, down in Malaysia, then you're putting through a huge gas processing plant and chilling it down, sending it on these giant tankers to, say, Japan, and then regasifying it, shipping the gas, producing electricity. It's a complicated system. We do it all the time. This is no more complicated than the things we already do with oil and gas and other energy sources.
Waterstof wordt al lang gebruikt. De Zeppelins in de jaren 30 bleven drijven omdat ze gevuld waren met waterstof. Maar met de ondergang van de Hindenburg in 1937 werd ook gelijk het gevaar van waterstof duidelijk.
And the flame is rising to the ground, not quite to the mooring mast. All the humanity and all the passengers screaming around me. I never talk to people whose friends are out there. I can't talk, ladies and gentlemen.
In 1997 toonde de NASA echter aan dat het niet de waterstof, maar de huid van de Zeppelin was die de snelle brand veroorzaakte. Die bleek beschilderd met een extreem brandbare verf. Desondanks blijven mensen bang voor ongelukken met waterstof.
How safe are light riders if someone were to hit you from behind? It's important to note that none of the cylinders lost any pressure during or after the drop tests.
I mean, gasoline is already nice and explosive if you want something. Natural gas, we already have explosions. This is no more dangerous than any of the other fuels. Fuels burn, you know, and that's what they're supposed to do. The hydrogen as a fuel is no more dangerous than any of the other fuels we already have in our system.
Met de veiligheid van waterstof lijkt het mee te vallen. Waterstof maken is ook het probleem niet. Bijvoorbeeld met windenergie. In de Verenigde Staten zijn verschillende zeer grote commerciële windprojecten. In de heuvels rond Tehachapi in Californië waait het altijd. Ze staan dan ook bezaaid met windmolens. Wind is er meer dan genoeg en ruimte om nog meer molens neer te zetten eveneens. Hetzelfde geldt voor de grote commerciële zonnecentrale in de Mojave-woestijn. De projecten bewijzen dat er genoeg duurzame energie te produceren is en dat je het commercieel succesvol kunt exploiteren. Maar er zit nog een ander interessant voordeel aan.
Instead of importing fossil fuels and paying somebody who brought it out of the ground there and brought it here, now you can use local labor and local resources to build this kind of facility, which takes a lot of people, a lot of labor, and then local crafts to operate the facility, and it utilizes the local resource as the fuel instead of sending those dollars and additional resources overseas. You can keep it in the local economy, and there's a multiplying effect in the local economy.
Windenergie en zonne-energie zijn duurzame bronnen die overal ter wereld aanwezig zijn. De derde wereldlanden bijvoorbeeld liggen in de meest zonrijke gebieden van deze aarde. Met die zon zouden ze daar elektriciteit kunnen maken en met die elektriciteit dan weer waterstof. Dan zijn ze ineens niet meer afhankelijk van olie en komt het geld in de lokale economie terecht. Rifkin kan er uren over doorpraten. Waterstof zou de derde wereld voorgoed kunnen verlossen uit hun afhankelijke positie.
So in the third world, they should leverage their micro and macro credit to get renewables into the villages and into the big urban areas, solar and photovoltaic on every roof, wind power, geothermal, hydro, get the fuel cells, set up the mini grids, then they can have electricity. And here's my point on this. The reason people are powerless is literal. It's actually literal. They don't have power. Two-thirds of the human race has never made a single telephone call. A third of the human race has no access to electricity. So if you're looking for dung, cow dung, or firewood for 4 hours a day to heat rice for your children, you're not in the 21st century. What we need to do is assure universal access to electricity. That should be the rallying cry all over the world. Everyone should have access to electricity with hydrogen renewables. Then we can have what I call stage two. Stage one was globalization from the top down. It was a failure because the globalization was too narrow and it was based on too elitist an energy regime. You know, fossil fuels are only found in certain parts of the world. It takes a huge military machine to secure them. 20th century was about securing oil. It takes a lot of capital investment to move oil, coal, and gas. So it's inevitable we ended up with a few dozen energy companies and a few hundred corporations running the oil regime. So, what's stage two? Stage one was globalization from the top down. It didn't work because only 20% of the human population was engaged. When your trade is only narrow to 20% of the population that could benefit, the other 80% were out of the loop, globalization failed. It was too narrow. It wasn't dense enough. And when four-fifths of the people aren't involved, you have greater political instability and loss of social trust. When you have no social trust, you can't remove boundaries. Globalization is about building trust so you can remove tariffs and regulations and boundaries and have flexible labor. You can't do that when four-fifths of the world doesn't trust the one-fifth that's running the game. So stage two is re-globalization from the bottom up, meaning if people can have access to electricity with renewables, then they can generate their own goods and services locally and sell globally. Then we have dense globalization where everyone is involved in exchanging economic activity, not just the top fifth. That's the revolution. And you cannot have sustainable development without it. When the protesters take to the streets in Seattle and Genoa and all these places, understand it's good to know what you're against, but you have to have a story of what you're for. Because we have to have something better to replace globalization. And what that something better is the ability to everyone to engage in economic trade if they have self-sufficient energy.
We're going to continue to use oil for a long time. Oil has high value. Even if when we stop using it as an energy source, it will be an input to chemical feedstocks. That's the best use for it, actually. That's the highest value. But we'll still use it for decades for energy. This transition will not happen instantaneously all over the world. It's a long process. So no matter what, it's going to be decades before we can radically reduce it. But the situation now is that everybody is so dependent, and every increment of new demand puts even more pressure on that market, that the producers have enormous control over price and availability. And so all the power rests with the producing countries. And so everybody has to play to the interests of the producing countries. If there's an alternative to oil, if hydrogen is beginning to take market share from that, from the world of oil, and every year as growth happens, more and more of that growth is moving toward hydrogen and less of it toward oil, then the power of the producers begins to diminish every year. They have to compete for those markets. They have to reduce the cost of oil. They can't raise the cost of oil. They have to become much more competitive to make it available, not to make it hard to get, and so on. So the power of the producers from a security perspective actively begins to diminish as soon as hydrogen becomes a reasonable alternative and begins to win market share. You don't have to eliminate the oil. You change the balance of power in the marketplace fundamentally. I think we need a project on the scale of the Apollo project. I mean, the power of Apollo was a shared vision, an alignment of effort that led to a heroic undertaking. And I think it's that scale of undertaking that we need here, a project that is defined as clearly, that is driven as much by a larger vision, and where we put the significant resources behind it to achieve that, where we aspire to something that is larger than most of the things we do try to achieve, particularly as a public society.
How much money should we spend on it?
Order of magnitude, over 10 years, $100 billion, or $10 billion a year, roughly. And to measure that in current terms, we're spending $3.8 billion a month in Iraq in sustaining the occupation. So this is roughly 2.5 months of the ongoing occupation of Iraq every year.
Yeah, but it sounds like a lot of money, $100 billion.
But relative to a $1 trillion budget, $10 billion is not a very large amount of money. I think the issue is not the money. I think the issue is the political will. The money is symbolic, and it is a statement of the organized effort to undertake something in a large-scale way. I think if you put it in terms, not so much of the transition to hydrogen, but in terms of reducing the dependence on imported oil and dealing with the global environmental problems we face, and frame it as the beginning and the end of the hydrocarbon era, that's a very different kind of set of goals than transition to hydrogen. Because who can get excited about hydrogen? But you can get excited about radical reductions in the environmental consequences of our economy and radical reductions in the tensions produced by oil dependence.
Een wereldwijd waterstofenergienet. Enorme kosten, gigantische opbrengsten, een nieuwe industriële revolutie, volop energie voor de derde wereld. Is de waterstofrevolutie niet een beetje een utopie?
You know, people say to me, there are so many problems here. The technology is not quite there, the costs are high, there's all of these other business and commercial players that are going to try to stop this, there are political interests engaged, how do we create the infrastructure, on and on and on, and I just smile and say, I know. This is... When you have energy regime changes, they are the most disruptive revolutions in history. They disrupt the technology, the infrastructure, the politics, and the commerce. But so what's new? You could have had a discussion, we could have had a discussion when James Watt patented the steam engine saying, oh my God, how are we going to move from wood to steam power? It's just going to be too many issues we can't resolve. Well, we did it. And then we could have the same discussion when we moved to oil and the internal combustion engine electrification. Well, that's impossible. How do we get there? We did it. So if we could do that in the first and second industrial revolutions, moving from wood to coal and then coal to oil, certainly we have the ability to move from fossil fuels to hydrogen and lay down the infrastructure. It's going to be tough. There's no panacea. This is not a utopian vision. It's about survival, and it's about what kind of future we want for our kids and how we want to spend our money, our tax money. And I think this is the legacy we ought to have. Go for the real story that's going to open up options for future generations. Don't get bogged down in all the old stories.
Voor meer informatie, het lidmaatschap op onze wekelijkse nieuwsbrief en reacties, surft u naar tegenlicht.vpro.nl. Hoe sterk is de zaak tegen Milosevic?
Please be seated.
So you're sitting across a man that you wanted to see dead.
Ja, dan weet ik niet of u toch wel een zaak heeft.
So ultimately, Milosevic ran this thing, just like a mafia boss.
We have not yet seen evidence of his planning or ordering ethnic cleansing, let alone genocide.
In Tegenlicht, de zaak Milosevic vervolgd.